timeless, weightless, boundless. Discovering the most fascinating landscapes on Earth by hot air balloon. 5 countries, 4 continents, 180 days. Up, up and away, with Phil and Ali Dunnington, an Anglo-German couple whose goal is to discover the world by balloon. Breathtaking flights. Dramatic landings. Exotic cultures. Unexpected encounters. Lighter than air, the balloon floats aloft, bringing us closer to man's oldest dream, the dream of flying. The Gran Sabana, isolated wilderness in southern Venezuela. For hot air ballooning, this is virgin territory. At 1,000 meters above sea level, this vast plateau is almost the size of Spain. And this is where Phil and Ali Dunnington meet up with German film director Werner Herzog. Their goal is the Tepuis, rising like islands from the Gran Sabana. These flat top mountains are shrouded in legend, each one a world unto itself. From Caracas, the balloonists traveled across the entire country. After 3 hours flight and 10 hours drive, they reach Santa Elena de Huaren in the southeast of Venezuela. The little town on the Brazilian border is not quite 100 years old. With only 30,000 inhabitants, it is still the largest settlement within a 200-kilometer radius. The central square is dedicated to Simón Bolívar. His charismatic leadership of the South American independence movement in the early 19th century confirmed his status as national hero ever since. With the help of tour guide Eric Bushbell, the balloonists get to know the special features of the town. Santa Elena came to life as a gold mining town. The Gran Sabana's gold and gemstone reserves have lured prospectors from around the world since the early gold rush days. Over time, the town also became a meeting point for tourists keen to explore South America.
Wow. Well, that's excellent.
There's a vendor selling freshly squeezed orange juice on almost every street corner. Welcome refreshment for Phil and Ali's ballooning team. Before the balloon takes off, Phil reconnoiters the area by plane. With him is Ivan Artai, organizer of adventure tours of all kinds and based in Santa Elena. They're looking for suitable takeoff and landing sites for the balloon. There are plenty of places to land in the almost deserted Gran Sabana. But apart from the road networks close to the sparsely scattered settlements or gold diggers' camps, there are very few other roads that would allow the balloon and its crew to be retrieved. It is a real problem. Phil's goal is the Tepuis. The bizarre flat-topped mountains are the symbol of the Gran Sabana. Some Tepuis rise up to 1,000 meters from the plain. Planning a hot air balloon expedition here seems risky. Where to take off and land when the terrain consists of virgin forest and steep rock faces? The only option is to have the balloon and its passengers taken by helicopter to a suitable place for takeoff, and if necessary, have them airlifted back out again. But the only helicopter in the area big enough to transport a balloon has just been downed in an accident. On the way back, Phil and Yvonne agree they have to play safe to begin with and stay in the savannah.
Because we don't have a helicopter, I think we can't risk flying over the mountain and landing somewhere that is away from a road. Yeah. And we just might run out of fuel and duration, and we could safely land, but without a helicopter we can't get back.
So yeah, that's a
problem. I think that's the safe option.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm agree.
So where are we looking at next?
Well, we flew today here. Mm-hmm. We passed already.
Yvonne knows the area well and suggests a takeoff location that will allow for a safe flight.
At least if we've got plenty of savannah, we can just go to one side or the other, depending on the wind.
Yes. And well, as you know, everything is possible, but nothing is easy.
Yeah.
At last, they're ready to start. The balloon will be escorted by Ivan's brother, Juan Carlos Atal, flying his paramotor. Juan Carlos and Ivan are local aviation experts. Both of them have been flying paramotors for 20 years. Today, the balloonists are keen to familiarize themselves with the Gran Sabana and its features. Juan Carlos' paramotor is an added safety factor. He can follow the balloon even in inaccessible areas.
Please.
Far away in the distance, the Tepuis beckon silently. But first, the wind and weather conditions need plotting very carefully. Phil takes off to check. The wind direction seems to be less favorable higher up, so he stays close to the ground. The balloon can only drift with the wind, but the paramotor can be steered almost like a small aircraft. The pace is leisurely. The wind direction good. The balloon's first flight of discovery in Venezuela takes it over the Lagunas Encantadas, the enchanted lakes. The savannah is a bare region, most of it not really suitable as grazing land. The grass is too coarse. The palm tree, however, is seen here as being the tree of life. Fruit, leaves or wood, every part of it can be used. The wind may be gentle, but it's still strong enough to make the balloon bounce about on landing.
Kangaroo flight.
As long as the wind doesn't blow on the balloon's envelope too hard, Phil keeps the balloon inflated, indicating his position. At first, the ground crew can't see him, as he's hidden behind the hills. The followers and their 4x4 only find the balloon when the paramotor shows them where to go. Now, Phil opens the parachute, the lid of the balloon, to let the hot air out. The balloon's maiden flight in Venezuela was successful. The symbol of Santa Elena de Juarez, also known in the vernacular as the unfinished Madonna, it has been awaiting completion for years. Long queues at the filling stations. This is partly due to the amazingly low price of petrol, as it's subsidized by the state. A full tank, nearly 80 liters, costs around $1. In neighboring Brazil, it is 100 times more expensive. Fuel might be cheap, but it isn't always available. That also applies to the propane gas used here for cooking and heating. Even the containers are a scarce commodity. The balloon's 15 gas cylinders had to be bought in Caracas and transported 3,000 kilometers to Santa Elena.
Now.
It takes about an hour to fill the 4 bottles with propane gas for the following day's flight. Time for a caipirinha.
Yeah. Yeah.
One cocktail later, the bottles are full and can be set up for the following day. The remaining gas cylinders are locked up carefully for the night. Next morning, the team welcomes German film director Werner Herzog.
Und Ellie, vielen Dank für die Einladung, hier dabei sein zu können.
Great.
Das sieht zwar nach einem Familienausflug aus, aber ich weiß, ihr habt was ganz Großes vor.
Super.
Mein Bruder, meine Frau.
Wir freuen uns riesig, mit euch in Venezuela zu sein. So, hoffen wir auf eine gute, schöne Fahrt gemeinsam.
Okay, ja.
So, I'll give you a quick but important safety briefing. As soon as the balloon is upright, please be close to the basket, ready to climb in. Climbing in happens with these footsteps here. That's going to be your compartment on the other side where the tanks are. Very important now, the landing position, which again is very simple. It's like a skiing exercise, so you bend your knees, feet flat on the ground, okay? But you face backwards. So if the balloon travels this way, you turn around, facing back like the stewardesses on an aircraft, and you will only hold in inside. You'll just kind of be here, have your shoulders level with the basket, yeah? So you're not sitting, you're not standing, and you're just told on any side things are like that. And you stay in here until I say it's okay to get out. Stay in there. Good. Okay, that's pretty much all. Any questions? Good. Okay, so we'll get started. Great.
Werner Herzog had already visited the twin Tepuis of Roraima and Kukenan 8 years earlier. Now he plans another excursion to the Table Mountains. The film director knows the Gran Sabana, but he's never flown in a hot air balloon.
Okay. Right, so hands on. Juhu!
Okay.
20 nach 7. Du bist in der Luft. Guck mal, wie schnell das hochgeht, ha? Ohne groß was zu machen, ja. So, wir sind jetzt auf 3000 Fuß, 1000 Meter. Ja, aber das ist Bodenhöhe, ne?
Not forgetting the accompanying paramotor, of course. In pleasant contrast to the little paramotor, the balloon mostly glides silently through the air.
Das Fahren im Ballon ist ja eine völlig andere Sehweise auf die Welt.
Absolut.
Ja. Ganz sanft alles.
Ja.
Anders als im Hubschrauber oder
definitiv.
Im Flugzeug, ja.
Das hat mich auch von meiner ersten Fahrt an total fasziniert. Und es ist halt
wir wissen nie, wo wir hingehen
richtig.
Werden. Ja.
Das ist, jetzt
ja. Das ist alles das immer offen.
Totale Abenteuer. Jede Fahrt ist anders. Man weiß nie, was passiert. Ich gebe jetzt kurz einen Brenner. Ist das jetzt Kukenan oder Roraima? Hier drüben, schau.
Ja, 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 das ist, glaube ich, Roraima.
Ja,
Roraima.
Ja,
das ist der Roraima, ja.
Super.
Ja, ich weiß, ihr habt was Großes vor. Dort hinten, wo der Berg ist.
Absolut.
Aber das wird schwierig, ich weiß das. Ich war ja schon mal auf dem Roraima und kurz auch auf dem Kukenan. Und wir werden das mal besser vorher testen.
Ja, ja, die Windverhältnisse und natürlich der Dschungel, mit dem die Tepuis umgeben sind, sind nicht gerade die leichtesten Bedingungen fürs Ballonfahren.
Ja, wenn ihr da Richtung Guyana reinfliegt, da kann euch niemand mehr rausholen.
Nee.
Da gibt es keine Flussverbindungen.
Richtig.
Das sind Katarakte,
ja.
Wasserfälle und Dschungel ohne jede Straße. Mhm. Das geht hunderte von Kilometern.
Ja.
Und da kann euch keiner mehr rausholen.
See, you're drifting westward very slowly, so we're just gonna stand here for a while.
Yeah, correct. We have Kukenan and Roraima beautifully in sight, so I think I might start just a little bit more here and then come down and see what I get. And still the plan is to land somewhere near the main road, so if you can just keep your toes following us.
Understood. We're just going back to the track and then we'll be making our way back towards the main road.
Back to the main road.
Unser Ziel ist, ihr seht diesen Feldweg da hinten. Das ist alles okay. Und zum Landen wäre die Straße gut, weil hier kommt ja kein Mensch her, richtig.
Ali shows her skill. She lets the balloon float just above the surface of the water. This technique, known as contour fly, requires a delicate touch. The balance between sinking and rising has to be exactly right. Burn too much, and the balloon rises. Burn too little, and the basket sinks into the lake. Retrieval would then be very difficult. The balloonists have got closer to the Tepuis today, but the weather is poor and Ali has to land.
Remember the landing position? I try to land maybe here on this track if we can.
Okay.
Let's do it. Pass a message.
Yeah, we're on the main road now. We're about 1 kilometer up west of Beam View.
Hold on, it's very wet here. Shit. Yeah, it's very wet here. Yeah, very wet. Yeah. Okay, hold on. Bang. Look back.
The grass is wet from the last rains. It's February, which is actually supposed to be the dry season in the Gran Sabana. But this year, the precipitation has been unusually high.
Yeah. Phil, just drive with the best car.
The track looks motorable about 20 meters from us. Where we are standing now is
pretty wet, but a good car, I think, can still do it.
Not ideal conditions, either for ballooning or for mountaineering. But both teams intend to stick to their plans.
Come in and stay in there. Why don't you stay for a while until we change tanks so you can all stay in there, okay? It's actually better for stability.
Hey, well, the family! Hey!
Oh, one up.
Time for a little sustenance. The teams stop at a churrascaria. These typically Brazilian steak restaurants are not exactly ideal for vegetarians. Here, it's all about meat, meat, and more meat. Werner Herzog and the balloon team tuck in with gusto. Soon their ways will part for a while as the director is drawn to the mountains. The Tepuis, shrouded as they often are in dense cloud. Werner Herzog has been waiting for days to be able to get up Kukenan. As the helicopter stationed in Santa Elena had crashed, a helicopter had to be sent in from the north. And then bad weather prevented them from taking off. But now, at last, they're ready. The expedition begins. The flight takes just half an hour, but the helicopter can only take 3 passengers at a time, so it has to make 3 flights to get the director, crew, and all their gear up to the mountain, 50 kilometers away. There are 115 Tepuis dotted around the Gran Sabana, relics of a prehistoric sandstone plateau. Over the millennia, erosion has worn away the sandstone, leaving behind flat-topped table mountains, such as Roraima and Kukenan. cut off from the surrounding savanna by its insurmountable scarp slopes. A whole world has evolved in isolation on their summit plateaus, much of it undiscovered right up to the present day. The Lost World is what Sir Arthur Conan Doyle titled his adventure story about the Tepuis and the animals he imagined living atop them. Inspiration for films such as King Kong and Jurassic Park. There are no dinosaurs, but the inaccessibility of the plateaus has certainly given rise to speculation about what does live up here. The helicopter has finally transported the entire expedition team to the mountain. They are welcomed by their Indian mountain guides, who climbed the adventurous route to the top. The team is now on its own, unreachable, and cut off from the rest of the world. Kukinan's rocky desert will be their home for the next few days. This will be their base as they explore the bizarre landscape of the plateau. Rocky overhangs offer at least a little shelter from the changeable weather. Welcome to Hotel Kukinan. In the local Indian vernacular, the Tepuis are known as the houses of the gods. There is another name for Kukinan. The Indians call it Matawi, the house of the dead. The mountain is regarded as being ominous. Years ago, a 13-year-old boy disappeared without a trace up here. A search party of 20 men spent 3 weeks looking for him in the rock fissures and ravines, but the mountain never gave him back. Since then, Kukinan has been generally avoided. Grueling expeditions are Werner Herzog's specialty. For one of his films, Fitzcarraldo, he even had an entire ship transported through the Brazilian jungle. During his brief visit 8 years ago, Werner Herzog was struck by Kukinan's primeval landscape. Today, he wants to capture on film some of the unusual images and impressions he still recalls.
Na, ich meine, du schwenkst rüber. Und rotierst die Kamera. Wenn du am Wasserfall herunterschaust,
kann ich so drehen.
Dann kannst du so drehen. Ah, ja. Schau doch mal, ob du.
The director has very specific ideas. At his bidding, water even flows upwards.
So weit wie du kannst.
Ja.
So dass am Schluss sozusagen diagonal nach oben geht.
Within minutes, the weather has changed. Now Kukinan shows its true colors. The team finally gives up and heads back to camp. As often happens, the mountains shroud themselves in cloud for an indefinite period. Thousands of meters below on the Gran Sabana, the weather is absolutely fine. Chidi Cayenne, a village in the shadow of another Tepuis. Our ballooning adventurers are going to try their luck here. To get closer to the mountain, they first have to travel through the virgin forest, and there are plenty of obstacles.
You have a Swiss knife.
A Swiss army knife isn't enough, though. The balloon crew has to wait until help arrives wielding bigger tools. Nowadays, you'll find power saws in every jungle village. All clear, and they carry on towards the mountain. The next day, the balloonists are on the road before sunup. Weather and takeoff conditions are usually good this early in the morning, but not today.
It's going to be a very difficult inflation this morning. I don't know whether we'll be able to manage it or not. But obviously we want it to be safe, and so the important thing is that everybody knows beforehand what they're supposed to be doing.
Despite treacherous wind conditions, they manage the inflation.
Good, very good inflation. End of the tether, that's good.
But the cloud front over the Chidi Cayenne Tepuis is advancing rapidly. A storm is imminent. Phil and Ali have to land quickly.
I have the radio.
Okay, yeah, unfortunately, we're drifting a lot towards the left.
I don't have to say, so...
Well, I don't want to get to this.
We're coming down in a minute because otherwise we're going to space. Yeah. And we land near the forest to the entrance of the village.
The balloonists are looking for a landing site close to the village, but the wind keeps blowing them away. They have to land before the next patch of forest, or they risk crash landing.
Yeah, I'll try and get... Yeah, I know.
Made it.
Now, get out now and go and keep it off the tree, please.
That's it, good. Well done, brilliant.
Oh, God, you don't need too many actions like that in a day, I can tell you. Wow. 10 minutes of very exciting flight.
But the Tepuis are still beyond reach of the balloonists. Meanwhile, atop Kukenan, Werner Herzog's film crew actually wanted to be back down on the savannah a long time ago. But for days now, the weather has prevented the helicopter from landing. At least there's full board and lodging. And running water. Mist and rain alter the perception of things, making rock and stone formations appear like a landscape full of mythical creatures and grotesque shapes. Anyone who gets left behind can quickly become disorientated in the rocky labyrinth.
Werner!
Werner! Werner!
Werner! Werner!
Is there a way around there? So I'll come?
No, I went upstairs. Werner!
After a few tense moments, the director reappears. He chose a different route through the treacherous terrain.
I kept around the corner at a high ledge, safe.
The overriding element on Kukenan is water. Fog and rain provide an inexhaustible supply. The plant world has adapted well to the moist conditions. Mosses and lichens absorb the water like sponges. Grasses and shrubs take root in the tiniest cracks in the rocks, defying wind and weather. In these lonely islands, creation has taken its own course, giving rise to flora and fauna that are unique to these plateaus. Carnivorous plants and orchids flourish particularly well in the nutrient-poor sandstone, and have developed in an amazing profusion of varieties. For millennia, evolution and erosion have been at work here in isolated seclusion, together creating a world so strange that it seems almost alien. The dense cloud causes huge volumes of water to be precipitated on the plateau. Swamps and tarn lakes overflow regularly, swelling little rivulets and turning them into streams and rivers. Until, finally, as torrential waterfalls, they hurl themselves off the edge of the Tepuis. In free fall for over 600 meters, the Kukinan waterfall is claimed to be the second highest on Earth. The foot of the Tepuis is mostly covered in dense virgin forest. It grows along the banks of the rivers well into the Gran Sabana. And in the middle of the jungle is another natural wonder, the Quebrada de Jaspe, an entire riverbed composed of the semi-precious stone jasper. The stone's red color comes from mineral oxides. Jasper is usually only found underground, but here it has been unearthed by the river and lends it a glamorous brilliance. Meanwhile, Werner Herzog's team has managed to get off the mountain, but it was a close shave. Kukinan and Roraima are almost always covered in cloud. The balloonists have still not reached their goal yet. Today is the last chance for Phil and Ali to fly at least close to the Tepuis with Werner Herzog.
Thank you, bye-bye.
Bye-bye, Venezuela. We see each other in Brazil.
He'll be leaving Venezuela tomorrow.
We're heading straight for Brazil.
Straight for Brazil, great.
Yes, yes.
Rio, here we come. And look at that, just look at the Tepuy sticking out of the cloud there. Our aim should really be to try and cross the Tepuy if we can at some stage.
Yes, but you know, last week we spent up there and there's no chance whatsoever. Mm. We went up there cowardly. We flew up a helicopter. I mean, it's way too difficult to climb it. And with camera gear, absolutely impossible. It needs real mountaineering. And it is really, really bad. So if you want to lose your life and balloon, which is probably more valuable.
Yes.
You have to give it a try.
With that, it was clear that flying over the Tepuis would, for now at least, remain a dream. Phil stays in touch with Ali by walkie-talkie, as the terrain is tricky. A rescue operation would take days, even if the paramotor pilots were able to put a precise fix on the balloon's location.
Along the rivers, there's a lot of smuggling of gasoline.
Really?
There's gold and all sorts of wild stuff going on there, precious gems, but the real deal is gasoline. They smuggle it in cars because here in Venezuela, they sell gasoline for, let's say, a huge tank full of gasoline for less than a dollar or so. and they transport it to Brazil or along the rivers into Guyana, and they make a fortune.
Wow. Maybe, but as we're going in that direction, we should have filled our tanks with gasoline. Ali, Phil.
The message.
Yeah, there's a track right below me now, and I think I'm going to have a go for that because I don't see one further on. Okay, Werner, we're going to be landing in just a moment, so if you're ready for your landing position. Wow, look at the Tepuis behind us now. Yes. That is magnificent.
That's where we should be.
Yes, we should. We should.
But you will lose everything.
Yeah,
we just can't do it.
At least we've seen it.
No chance, no chance, no chance. It was as soft as it can get.
Yeah, that was perfect, and we're at the end of a track, you see, so that's what we need. So, short but sweet, huh?
Yes, but look at how beautiful it's up there. You see, we needed that kind of weather. There was rain and storm, I mean, real ferocious, ferocious. And very demanding. I lost all my skin here in the face.
Yeah, and now the weather clears and we can see it at last.
There's nothing getting as close to science fiction than that here. It looks like an alien world.
Yeah, amazing.
Like outer space, you have nothing like this on this planet, ever, anywhere. I've seen a lot, but this is unbelievable up here.
It's time to say goodbye to Werner Herzog and the Tepuis ballooning project. The convoy heads back to Santa Elena. Time for a break and to pick up a few souvenirs. Many of the locals live off the tourist industry. In the little cultural museum, tour guide Eric Bushbell explains how the Bemon Indians made their everyday items and how they were used. Blowpipes are usually children's toys. But what Eric relates has a very adult history.
Hier haben wir den Brautfänger. Das ist, wenn die Bemon eine Zeremonie machen und die verloben sich. Am Ende dieser Zeremonie kommt dann der Mann, der nimmt dann seine ausgewählt, sagt: Bitte um deinen Finger, nicht um die Hand, sondern nur den Finger. Und wenn man das hier zusammendrückt, dann weitet sich das. Dann kann man das hier überstülpen. Und dann nehme ich dich und ziehe dich in meine Hütte rein. Und dann bleibt übrig.
They have to have one last flight. They plan to spend the night in the open. They won't be doing any ballooning in this rain, though.
3 o'clock tea, 5 o'clock gin tonics, 6 o'clock caipirinha, 7 o'clock wine.
But the alternative program is still on the cards. In the shelter of an abandoned Indian settlement, the adventurers put up their tents. The next morning heralds the last flight over the Gran Sabana.
Okay, bye-bye, guys.
Juan Carlos is there again as their airborne escort.
Brauerei mal auf der rechten Seite und dann gucken dann links davon. Wunderschöner Blick, ha?
Ali climbs up high. Quite risky, as clouds begin to gather below her balloon. Balloons have no radar to give them advance warning of any danger. And enveloped by cloud, they can neither see nor be seen. Nature puts on a particularly spectacular show with the interplay of light and clouds. The balloon is in the middle of a rainbow. And Phil and Ali float over the vast plains of Venezuela, heading for new adventures.